So, of course, I'd like to begin by thanking Subhro and everybody else for the opportunity to speak here. And a special thanks to Subhro for keeping me second, not first, today morning. So I'm going to tell you about some work done in fits and starts over the last 4 or 5 years, mainly by my student Sambuddha Sanyal, who's just started as an assistant professor in ICER Tirupati now. So this is sort of a massively late writing up of old work, but let me tell you about it. So the goal here is to try and convince you that there's at least one tractable situation in which we can do a numerically exact calculation which shows random singlet phenomenology of disordered, frustrated, SU2 symmetric antiferromagnetic. So that's the message. So for the rest of the talk, I'll just justify the statement I just made. So let me start with some background. So we all know, at least most of us know, that if you put phosphorus inside silicon, dilute concentration of phosphorus inside silicon, each phosphorus atom behaves like a sort of a giant hydrogen atom. There's an extra electron orbiting around a charge center. And as you increase the density of the phosphorus dopants, these electrons find it easier to hop across from one atom to the next. And it's really a picture in terms of a sort of a disordered half-filled Hubbard model on a random three-dimensional lattice. And at very low concentrations of phosphorus, this is an insulator. As you increase the concentration of phosphorus, there's an impurity band that develops and it eventually becomes metallic. But our interest is in the regime where the concentration is dilute enough that it's a good insulator, but it has interesting magnetic properties. So at very low energies and temperatures, the physics of this system is then the physics of localized electrons, whose charge degree of freedom is basically frozen, and whose spin degree of freedom interacts via some virtual process. And so very long ago, Bhatt and Lee developed a very nice renormalization group type of argument, phenomenology if you wish, that explained a lot of observations about systems like this. What they pointed out was that when the distribution of locations is random, and the exchange couplings depend exponentially on that distance between magnetic moments, you have to a very good approximation, an extremely broad distribution of Heisenberg exchange couplings, antiferromagnetic exchange couplings between spins. And then it makes sense to start thinking in a renormalization group picture where you take the two spins that are closest to each other, which have the strongest antiferromagnetic coupling between them, and form a singlet. And when you do that, the couplings between the other spins will get renormalized in some way. You take that into account at some level. And you keep doing this until you reduce the largest coupling in your renormalized problem, J tilde, to a cutoff scale which is equal to the temperature at which you want to calculate something or the frequency at which you're measuring something. And if you think like this, it's very clear that if you have such a broad distribution and you've gone down to some low cutoff scale T, and the number of pairs that survive at that scale is n of t, then the susceptibility is going to be to a very good approximation, n of t divided by t. The idea is that all the local moments that survive up to that cutoff scale temperature are going to be effectively free on the scale of the temperature, in the sense that the fraction of couplings, the surviving couplings that have values comparable to t is negligible, and you can treat all of them as free, and then you just have a Curie tail coming from each surviving moment. So that's the Bhattacharjee phenomenology for phosphorus doped silicon. And in practice, when you do this procedure numerically on the computer, you find this looks like a power law, not quite 1 over T, not quite a Curie tail, but a slower divergence in temperature. But the coefficient alpha, the exponent alpha is not really a fixed exponent. It's a slowly varying function of temperature that's slowly going to zero. That's what it looks like. This was the origin of this sort of random singlet picture for systems. I think historically this was perhaps the first or the second calculation. And at some point we thought a bit harder about this and realized that you can also use their picture to work out the density of triplet excitations above the singlet ground state of the system. And by exactly the same logic, you can argue that this chi double prime of omega, for example, is nothing but the density of pairs with renormalized couplings at the cutoff in the renormalized problem with cutoff equal to omega. So chi double prime omega is just dn d omega, where n is the number of surviving pairs. This gives you a very nice diagnostic for whether this picture really works. One of the nice things about this picture is that it contains within itself a diagnostic that tells you whether the picture is valid. And that diagnostic is a measure of the distribution, is a measure of the width of the distributions in the renormalized coupling. So if you are at cutoff scale omega and you want to ask how wide are the probability distributions of the couplings, a simple way to think about it is to form this ratio where you just take the total number of pairs that have survived and divide it by the number of pairs at the cutoff, d and d omega, and normalize this by omega so that you get a dimensionless number. This dimensionless number is a dimensionless measure of the disorder strength, of the width of the distribution. And you can relate this to measurable quantities like this. So the inverse of the width of the distribution would just be, at some cutoff scale omega, would just be chi double prime at that omega divided by the measured uniform susceptibility at a temperature equal to. So this is, so if you have a measurement of both these and you compare them and form this ratio, if this number is becoming very small, the distributions are very wide. That's a sort of phenomenological diagnostic, one would say. So, and you can connect this slightly varying, slowly varying exponent alpha to this diagnostic for the width of the distribution just by noticing that delta involves derivatives with respect to the log of the energy. So the natural scale is this log variable, log energy or log cutoff. And in those terms, delta is just n divided by d and d gamma. The inverse can then be computed and related to the exponent alpha. If alpha actually remains constant, it's really a power law. With a large z and alpha is 1 over z, so alpha is a tiny exponent. That's sort of finite but strong disorder, where alpha goes to 0, it's infinite disorder, asymptotically at low enough energies. So that's the picture of Barton Lee with a little bit of embellishment. So what's the status of this phenomenology? Well, in one dimension, it's well known that this is actually an asymptotically exact picture for random exchange, anti-ferromagnetic chains. This was something that was realized by Dasgupta and Ma, and then later with an analytical solution by Daniel Fisher. And the susceptibility is indeed of this form. It's some log correction to 1 over temperature. So it's a log corrected Curie tail. That's the susceptibility. This log correction shows up as a slowly varying exponent, of course, like that. And the number of pairs that survive at scale gamma is 1 over gamma square. The width of the distributions is growing without bound as gamma. This is what happens in a one-dimensional chain. This is a simple, analytically tractable case. What is the status of this phenomenology in D bigger than one? Well, it's far more confused. So if you look at SU2 symmetric Heisenberg antiferromagnets, it looks like, although the original computation of Bhatt and Lee was valid in the range of temperatures over which it was done, if you try to ask the sort of more theoretical question of whether it's really flowing to infinite disorder and the distributions are broadening, there's a lot of unpublished work that suggests it's not. And you start getting these local moments that form, which are larger and larger spins. And maybe the ultimate low energy fate of the system is maybe some sort of spin glass. It's not clear. But it's at a temperature scale that's very low for phosphorus doped silicon, so it's not relevant. But there's a theoretically interesting question then, whether you can have this random singlet phenomenology as an asymptotically exact statement in any SU2 symmetric Heisenberg antiferromagnet with disorder in higher than one dimension. So that's sort of the motivation. And there's been a lot of recent interest actually in this kind of phenomenology, purely as a phenomenology to explain some data. I think sparked partly by this paper from Senthil's group, where they looked at YBMG GA04 and tried to argue that many of its features, many of its measured properties, can be thought of in terms of the random singlet physics induced by bond disordered VBS phases. So the idea is there's some VBS phases near a spin liquid phase, and when you have bond disorder, you nucleate these moments, and those moments interact with the broad distribution of couplings that form a random singlet state. There's a picture like that. And motivated by this, Anders Sandvik and collaborators have actually constructed one of these model Hamiltonians, these designer Hamiltonians, which when you do the numerics for, it does look like you get some kind of random singlet phase in these systems. And then this has been pushed a bit further by taking a whole bunch of different frustrated antiferromagnets and trying to fit data using some sort of random singlet form for the susceptibility and the specific heat. And the claim is that if you take the random singlet phenomenology, add to it some spin orbit effects that change the low temperature behavior, add a small Curie tail whose origins are not clear, you can explain all this data in a fairly unified way. So that's the background to what I want to tell you about. So what I'm going to tell you about will say nothing about these materials, but will produce one exactly solvable example where this phenomenology does apply in a very straightforward way. So what we are going to find is that there's a SU2 symmetric Majorana spin liquid on the honeycomb lattice with full SU2 symmetry, that is. So where the susceptibility has two terms. One is just a Curie tail. And the Curie constant is not just sort of isolated spins created by some disorder effects. It's a cooperative effect. The Curie constant is a cooperative effect. Which is somehow surprising. And then there is exactly this random singlet form of the susceptibility, which is now a subdominant term because there's a Curie. And this should be thought of really as the magnetic response of emergent magnetic moments carried by spin textures that are produced by the disorder. These spin textures live on fairly large length scales. 30, 40, 50 lattice units is typical. Much larger is also possible. And this exponent alpha of t, its temperature dependence does have a form controlled by a strong disorder fixed point. And so this provides a proof of principle. So that's what I want to tell you about. So let me get there. So of course, before I tell you that, let me also say that a natural question that will arise when I tell you this story is whether we actually have an understanding of why this is happening. I mean, we do a calculation, we get an answer. The calculation is not in the language of freezing singlets. So is there a picture, is there an underlying picture where I can really do a renormalization group calculation and get the same answer? I think yes, at some structural level, but we haven't carried it through. So here's the model. This is a model introduced by Hong Yao and Tangai Li, which is kind of a nice variant on the Kitai model, I think, at least. So their initial starting point was a decorated honeycomb lattice where every honeycomb lattice point becomes a triangle. A sublattice points become up-pointing triangles, B become down-pointing, something like this. Like that. So this would be just the triangular lattice if I did that for this bond. But this is the decorated lattice. So the degrees of freedom in their original model live where the crosses are. And those are the degrees of freedom that you start with, but these are not those degrees of freedom. You have some multi-spin couplings in their exactly solvable model, which in the low energy limit tell you that each triangle forms a singlet, each triangle forms a doublet, and these doublets interact with each other. So the point is there are two doublets for every triangle, because there's two spin half states for three spin half variables, two total spin half states for three spin half variables. And those two are distinguished by a kind of an orbital quantum number, which has its own Pauli matrix tau. So you should think of tau z equal to plus minus 1 as the two possible s total equal to half states of each triangle. And then they are coupled. So there's a s dot, s is the total spin of each triangle. So it's a spin half variable, another Pauli matrix, sorry. So these two are also Pauli matrices coupled with a regular Heisenberg term. But the strength of the Heisenberg term is not a constant, it's a dynamical variable. It's actually got this Kitai form. So along an X bond, it's tau X, along a Y bond, it's tau Y, along a Z bond, it's tau Z, tau. So that's the model. Seems like a really weird model. And yes, it is a weird model, but it has a nice property. It's exactly solvable. And it has full SU2 symmetry. And it's nice. You'll see how it works. So this is the picture. The picture is you started with a Heisenberg model with some multi-spin couplings here. In the low energy sector, these want to make doublets. The doublets are the total spin half s, and there are two doublets per triangle. That's the tau variable. That's the model. So there's a simple way of solving this model, which is why I think they constructed it, which goes back to a Majorana representation that was popularized both by work in the US by Coleman, Miranda, and Swellick, and here by Sriram Shastri and Deepti Mansen. And this is sort of a representation where you write each Pauli matrix cyclically like this. Sigma z becomes minus I, cx, cy, and so on. So c's and b's here are Majorana fermions, real fermions. So there's a cx, cy, cz at each side that represents the Pauli matrix sigma, which is the variable that is the total spin half of each triangle. And there's a Pauli matrix b, there's a Majorana fermion bx, by, bz that represents the tau Pauli matrices, which are the orbital quantum number. So if you write this down and just rewrite that Hamiltonian, this one, something nice happens. You get a Hamiltonian that looks exactly like three copies of the Kitaev model. So the Kitaev model would have no index alpha here. There would just be one C operator. There would have been a Bx, By, Bz, which pair up to make the static gauge field U in the Kitaev model. So you have the same static gauge field U, which is not a dynamical variable, which just gets frozen into some sector. But now you have three copies of the Majorana fermion Hamiltonian of the Kitaev model. So there's one small subtlety when you go from the original model to this, which is of course a question of projection. So because you've introduced these Majorana fermions, you've double counted states. So at every site R of my model, I should have only four states, but I have eight. And so I have to reduce the number of states by two. And that's done by noticing that this is actually a double counting representation in the sense that there are two completely faithful representations of the Pauli matrices sitting here. So you can construct this operator cx, cy, cz, bx, by, bz with the I in front, and it has eigenvalues plus or minus one. Both sectors, plus one and minus one, have four states each. In these four states, this representation is completely faithful. So there's two faithful representations here. It's not like one is not faithful, not physical, and the other is faithful. They're two completely physical representations. You could use either one. You could even choose to use one at one site and the other at the other side. You could choose d equal to plus one at a site and d equals minus one at another site. It's up to you. But you have to fix what your value of d is for each site. And that's the projection you have to do. And that's important because once you sit in one sector with one d, there is this magic that happens. A sigma times a tau, which would actually be a four fermion operator, becomes a bilinear. And that's why it's exactly solvable. So anyway, that's just technical aside. The bottom line is it becomes free fermions. And we are going to study this free fermion problem and ask what is the susceptibility. And the susceptibility in the free fermion language will just be the compressibility at the particle hole symmetric chemical potential. How much time do I have? Oh, lots of time. Okay, good. So let me go back one. I'll come to that in a minute. So first, let me just say I skipped ahead here. From the Majorana fermions, I first go to this convenient canonical fermions. I just write Cx minus Icy at each site and call it a canonical fermion F. And then I notice that Sz, I'm applying a Z magnetic field to calculate the susceptibility. Sz simply becomes the number operator for these F particles. And the third Majorana Cz drops out of the calculation of the susceptibility, so I don't need to worry about it. So I can really just think of a tight binding model for regular fermions on the bipartite honeycomb lattice. And these regular canonical fermions see a static Z2 gauge field, which is this one. So that's the picture. And for that model, I want to compute the susceptibility, and that becomes the compressibility. And so I can write down an expression from sort of undergraduate physics. It's just the integral over the whole band, 1 over t times the integral over the whole band of the total single particle density of states of this tight binding model times this factor. No, so it's free fermions. That's why I can solve it. It's only hopping. It's exactly this. So just replace the C's by f dagger f. Just hopping. But they see the static gauge field. So you have to be in the right gauge field sector to be in the ground state. That's the only. So coming to Subir's question, in the usual Kitaev model, we understand projection quite well now. We know that, for example, for almost everything we compute, the projection only gives some subleading corrections to the thermodynamic answer or any thermodynamic quantity we calculate. And this is basically because the projection amounts to a constraint on the total parity of some fermion. And you always, so you worry about whether what you're missing when you don't put that in, and you analyze that and you find that it's subdominant in the thermodynamic limit. But there's an even nicer thing you can do for numerical calculations. You can take semi-open boundary conditions on your honeycomb lattice. So you have two edges, let's say two armchair edges, and then you wrap it like this. Then on the armchair edges, there are some dangling bonds. And so there are these dangling orbitals which have no Hamiltonian. There are Majorana fermions in there which have no Hamiltonian. So whichever, so if you have a state in the wrong sector, all you have to do is change the occupation number of the boundary orbital and it becomes a state in the right sector. So projection is not an issue. Every state contributes with a factor of half that you put. So basically, you can choose boundary conditions where there are even no subleading corrections. So this is a nicer way to take the thermodynamic limit than with tori. With a torus, you will have a subdominant correction that's going to zero. Here, with the sample you make, you can do an exact calculation for it without a projection correction, and then you try to take the thermodynamic limit of these strips. Right? So there's a way of doing it so that there's no projection issue. So there's some understanding of what flux sector you have to be in. If you are in a pure system with some reflection symmetries, there's Leap's theorem that tells you that every hexagon should have zero flux. And if you are a multiple of four in edge length, then you should have a pi flux. But with these, so I'm going to look at a disordered model where there's no theorem, but the same heuristic seems to apply. People have checked it. To be in the ground state sector, you have to put pi flux for every loop that has a multiple of four length. And zero flux for multiple of two, but not multiple of four, right? So you go to that flux sector, you're at the low temperature limit, you do the calculation. That's what we're going to do. So without, and with the specific kind of disorder I'm looking at is site dilution. So there's some non-magnetic impurities that dilute the original magnet. So they correspond to missing orbitals in the tight binding model. So that site is just missing. We're just looking at that problem. So without the flux attachment question, without putting pi fluxes wherever there are loops of length 12 or whatever, this is just the site diluted tight binding model for graphene. That's all it is, right? And this has this bipartite or chiral symmetry. Every eigen energy epsilon has a partner minus epsilon, and the density of states is symmetric about zero because you can change one wave function to the other by changing the sign of the wave function on one subline. A lot is known about these bipartite random hopping problems. In one dimension, for example, there's a very old calculation from the 1950s, I think, which predicts that the density of states has this very singular behavior near zero energy, this very strong divergence called the Dyson form. And the way really to think about it is to define the integrated density of states up to energies 10 to the minus gamma and ask what n of gamma is. And n of gamma is just a power law, 1 over gamma square. So dn d gamma is 1 over gamma cube. So that's the Dyson form. And there's a kind of a controlled RG way of thinking about it, where you sort of eliminate bonds in exactly this Buttley way and build states one by one. And you can show that you get exactly this answer. But more importantly, if you have an answer, you can check whether it corresponds to a strong disorder fixed point by using this diagnostic that I was talking about earlier. You just look at d and d gamma, divide by n, ask if it's going to zero. As gamma goes to infinity, as energy goes to zero. If it does, then you are in a strong disorder regime. Then the low energy physics is controlled by some strong disorder description, I would argue. Right? So in this problem, indeed, this is 1 over gamma. Gamma is going to infinity. So the distributions are broadening as gamma. That was the measure of disorder strength I was giving you earlier. In two dimensions as well, a lot is known about this. Gardier and Wegener, quite a long time ago, predicted that the corresponding behavior, this is power law, they predicted a stretched exponential, which is a faster decay, which means a slower divergence at zero energy. And there's some small corrections to their prediction, but basically you can show that the distributions broaden as gamma to the one-third. So it's still an infinite disorder fixed point, but the flow to infinite disorder is very weak. So this is what's known about not the site diluted problem, but just random bonds, random hopping. So the problem with vacancies, I think, has a shorter history. The first time anybody tried to look at it numerically was, I think, this paper of Adam Villans It was his thesis, I think. And they found this NF gamma behaves like a power law in two dimensions for site diluted Kitaev model, the regular Kitaev model, with a pretty small exponent. And this is a surprising violation of sort of this Gardey-Wegener universality. And so question was, what's going on? And perhaps motivated by this, group around Merlin made a prediction that actually there's some change in the universality class when you dilute the system and you get a power law behavior, which is like one-dimensional. And they claimed this was exact. There was some numerics supporting it. But so, you know, we looked at it more closely in graphene a few years ago, and we found that although there's a long crossover where indeed it does look like a power law, so I'm just plotting NF gamma versus gamma, power law in this would be a straight line because it's a log-log plot, and the stretched exponential would be a downward curvature. You can see that, you know, up to energy scales of 10 to the minus 8, right, gamma of 8 is 10 to the minus 8, it really does look like that, then it crosses over. So there's some anomalously slow crossover here to the Gardey-Wegener form. But asymptotically, you have Gardey-Wegener physics. This is just a theoretical point I want to make. So we've revisited the calculation then of Adam Bilan's thesis as well to see whether the same thing's going on with flux attachment. And indeed, we find the same physics. We have the same crossover. We have power law and then stretched exponential. And the crossover is non-universal, not surprisingly. It depends on how you put in the vacancies, which then control the number of zero modes. But what you can say is that it's the number of zero modes. There are some zero modes as well, which I didn't talk about, that control this crossover. And let me talk about those now. So they're just a delta function in the density of states, right? The Gardey-Wegener form is wrong. And so the real answer seems to be that the non-zero energy states are exactly Gardey-Wegener, plus there's a delta function. That seems to be what happens with side. A delta function at zero. There's a non-zero density of zero modes. Exact zero modes, not broadened by anything. And in fact, I can show you how they're actually robust to bond disorder. That's the amazing thing, yes. Well, it's actually quite simple, but it sounds amazing, yes. I'll tell you about it. So let me get to that. So this is about the free fermion problem. As far as this talk is concerned, this is just background, right? I'm going to use these results. And so let me get to the zero mode. So when we looked in detail at diluted graphene, we found there's a non-zero density of zero modes. So this is the extrapolation to the thermodynamic limit of the number of zero modes per unit area. So it's a non-zero thermodynamically significant density. It's like 0.5% of zero modes. And it's concentration dependent, of course. This is the concentration of vacancies. Right? So more vacancies you put in, there are more zero modes. And there's some curve there. So we find the same thing happens in the Kitaev model, and the numbers are actually very similar. The flux attachment doesn't seem to change the density of zero modes much. And that's really the clue to what's going on. So I'll tell you about that if you ask me a question. But here, let me conclude my talk and say, which is exactly right, this, if I now translate to the susceptibility, will give me exactly what I was claiming it would give. And so let me put that up once. It would give exactly this. So the zero mode density would give me this term, and that Gardey-Wegener density of states, that crossover from power law to Gardey-Wegener density of states, put together would simply control the form of alpha of t as t goes to zero. So that's a detail at this level. How alpha of t goes to zero is a detail. The fact is it goes to zero as t goes to zero. So this is really exactly what you would expect for a random singlet fixture. And this is an SU2 symmetric system. So I'm claiming that it has all the ingredients. It has a Curie tail that's somehow a cooperative effect. It's not from one spin, but some things come together to give a local moment. It has a strong disorder fixed point that controls what's going on at low temperature. It's got SU2 symmetry, and it's got an answer in this form. So that's really what I want to say. But please ask about the free fermion problem. I'll be happy to tell you. So let me just go to the end of the talk. Thank you.
Questions?
Yeah. Yeah, so the C is just directly this number. It's the density of zero modes. Yeah, so, exactly that. Yeah.
So, let me make sure. So the disorder you put in are either site dilution or bound disorder.
Site dilution and bond disorder.
And bond disorder. Right?
But the explicit results I'm showing you right now are site dilution.
Only site dilution.
Yeah. So the difference between the two is basically unobservable.
So when you do site dilution,
yeah.
Have you keep so, a balance between just, A and B sublattices?
Yeah, let me just correct one thing. So I said the difference between site diluted and bond disorder is basically unobservable. What I mean is, if I have site dilution, then putting bond disorder on top of that doesn't seem to change anything. But if I have only bond disorder, then it's of course a different problem.
So when you do site dilution,
it's balanced. Yes,
the A and B sublattices are still balanced.
Yeah.
And you still have a
compensated disorder. The number of A sites is equal to the number. Vacancies go equally on the two lattices, and that's of course true statistically. But I enforce it at the level of every sample.
I see. Yeah. So, but you still have an exact zero energy mode.
Yes.
That's so,
I have two quick questions. One is, if you have delta functions with no even exponential tail, how can you couple to these modes?
Yeah, so they're completely robust to coupling except via the gauge field. If it becomes dynamical, then these modes get
smaller. The second one, by way of motivation, you said at the beginning that you have very broad distribution of singlets.
Yes.
And you mentioned the work with very broad distribution of triplets. So how do you know that you can...
Very broad distribution of singlets, yes.
So, there may be some overlap between the two. So how can you treat only the singlets?
No, so the statement...
No triplets.
No. So the statement about triplets was that you can view the renormalization group procedure as an iterative construction of the ground state. You're constructing the structure of the ground state at larger and larger length scales.
Without any mixing with triplets.
Without any mixing with triplets. Now,
that's a now statement.
That's a, I think, asymptotically exact statement for the 1D chain from Daniel Fisher's calculations. Now, you can take that same calculation and say, I stopped the calculation at some point, at some cutoff scale. So you've formed some part of the ground state. The other variables you've not yet decided what to do with. Right? Now you can ask, what do you know about the spectrum of excited states about that ground state you're constructing? And you can say that if you've stopped the RG process at some scale omega, then if you look at the surviving pairs and only take pairs which have coupling equal to omega, equal to the cutoff, then those are the ones which would get decimated at that scale and form a singlet. And so you're accurately able to say that the singlet triplet excitations of that pair have exactly energy omega. And so in this way, you get the density of triplet excitations about the singlet ground state, above the singlet ground state. Yeah.
What protects the finite density of zero?
It's connected with what he's saying. What did you say? What
protects the finite density?
Yeah, so it's connected with what he's saying. He asked me whether I have got the number of A sites different from the number of B sites in the whole sample. And I said, no. I make sure that every sample is balanced. But if you just do Poisson statistics and put stuff up, in local regions of the sample, there can be an imbalance. Typically, there will be a square root of area imbalance. In a typical, if you draw a circle of area A, there will be an imbalance which is square root of A. Yeah, so that, let me finish. Exactly. So you're anticipating everything I'm saying. So the next question is, how does that help me make zero modes? Because after all, it'll be connected to the outside world. How does that help? So let me draw you a picture and I think it'll be clear. So here's some arbitrary region, which I call a R-type region, RA. I'll tell you what this is. This has only B sites on the boundary. So everywhere on the boundary here, it has B sites. So its connections to the rest of the lattice is via B sites. Right? Now, if you take a typical region like this on a lattice, it'll have more B sites than A sites. Because, you know, there's a whole boundary's worth of excess B sites. And then the inside in the bulk, it'll on average. But you've got some very atypical region where the boundary is all B, but the number of A sites is bigger than the number of B sites. So sites are connected to stuff. So everything is connected to everything else. So if you look at the geometric aspects of this, if you just ask, are there more than one connected components of my lattice? The answer is no. The whole lattice is one connected component. But I'm saying inside that lattice, which is one connected component, if I can identify a region with this property, then I can construct Na minus Nb zero modes that live entirely in this region. Their wave function depends on details, you know, what are the couplings between sites, etc. But the fact that they exist is independent. So in that sense, they are insensitive to bond disorder. And why do I say this? Well, what's a zero energy solution of that tight binding model Schrodinger equation? Well, let's construct a solution which only lives on A sites and is zero on B sites. If it's zero on B sites, it's not going to leak out of this region. I just need to ask if it can be constructed. The number of variables is Na. The number of Schrodinger equation components I have to solve is Nb. So I have more variables than equations, there's always solution. That's all. It's 12th standard linear algebra. Right? Okay. First year IIT. You learned it and I did.
Any other questions?
Yeah. Yeah. We measure just the susceptibility. So right now, I'm just quoting the result for the susceptibility.
So this is SD for the triangle cluster.
Sorry?
I mean, the Hong-Yao's model, this, I mean, the
So I'll tell you what in Hong-Yao's model. Yeah, so what susceptibility am I measuring, right? Because there's two different Pauli matrices. So I'm thinking of this as just an orbital degree of freedom, which is how they motivated the model. And this is what's carrying the magnetism, capital S. And so I'm just measuring the susceptibility of that SU2 symmetric magnet.
So that S is the total
spin of the total spin, which is what you would do, no? If you put an external magnetic field, it would couple to S in his model. So that's correct, I think. Right?
Two quick questions.
Yeah.
How does it scale with the number of vacancies?
Yeah, so that's the part we don't have a good theory for, Ashwin. I can show you what it looks like. It's just some nondescript curve. And that's all I can say at this point. There, for example, it's just this, it's going to zero as the number of vacancies goes to zero, but there's more to it than that nondescript curve. It turns out that the way it goes to zero is that the typical size of these regions I'm talking about grows and becomes infinite in the low vacancy limit, but the number of zero modes inside each of them shrinks. And so there's some sort of scaling here, and we can actually fit it to like a percolation transition at PC equal to zero. You know, it's like we have percolation and we only see one side of the percolation transition. We don't see the percolated side, we see the approach to percolation. So NV going to zero is like approaching a percolation point from the unpercolated side. And so we can actually, we have some nice scaling plots of the geometric properties of these regions.
And maybe it's... but if I put a little bit of generic perturbation, say a
So I think there's two aspects to it, right? Yeah. One is that it'll reduce the flux gap. It's already small, it gets smaller. That doesn't matter so much, right? You agree. Particularly because you see these zero modes don't care what flux sector I'm in. They're completely robust to bond disorder. I can think of flux sector information as a kind of bond disorder. So I really don't care. So if I'm just doing some thermodynamic, if thermally excited fluxes, don't matter. But when they get dynamical, I think this breaks down. And the scale on which it breaks down is the bandwidth of the flux, the bandwidth of the vortex motion.
What do you get then? I mean,
I don't know. So in fact, I would love to do some calculation like that with some mean field treatment to try and extend this a bit, but I haven't yet succeeded.
Okay, let's thank Kedar again for that.